Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Invisible Girl, Luna Novella, by C.L. Farley, read by Clare Staniforth. The Melting Point of Glass. Maggie lifted her hand until her fingers aligned with the cracks in the sky. She traced the bloody fissures across the blue, her fingers travelling into the last light of day while her feet followed. Only the fence bordering the vegetable patch stopped her from chasing the sunset into its eventual death. She gripped the wire mesh, keeping her caged in life, an unfair oversight when so many others had died to the shadows, died in her hands.
"You're dawdling, girl."
"Eya, meh,"
Maggie replied.
"The maroch isn't going to harvest itself, and I still want to eat tonight."
"It won't take long."
Maggie turned to Pauline, who sat on a large rock near the middle of the garden. Her hair was neatly trimmed and brushed out, and she definitely wasn't dead, even if Pauline's lips were red like warning lights. Sometimes Maggie dreamed about how different the earth smelled when you dug deep enough, and Pauline's sheet-wrapped body, fragile as a bunch of sticks, exploding into a flock of mercurochrome red weaver birds when the first spadeful of dirt landed on her chest. But a slippery wrongness lived in the memory. It had something to do with the picture quality on the TV the catfish spat out for Maggie while she was drowning. If Pauline had died, then who had held her tight and stroked her hair during that first night after she was exiled from the zoo? Who was watching her now with pursed lips and tapping fingers? Maggie frowned against the wall her thoughts had run into. Ideas didn't used to be this wormy, but her brain was all boxes and water slides now. Navigation was a hand finding a wall in the dark. She was giving herself a headache. Pauline shook her head and said something in Susutu, too quick and low for Maggie to hear. She turned back to the sunset, to the light, and the monsters roaming the felt beyond the fence. The creatures were chimeras of mismatched animal parts, elongated to weird proportions by the sinking sun, children of light, skinned with shadows and fear. One of them stalked wobbly circles on a boulder that rose above the tall yellow grass. Its back half resembled a leopard, the front half an African wild dog, and the massive tusks sprouting from its head were straight off an elephant. The position of the tusks was misleading, a trickery that brought to mind the massive horns of those cattle Uncle Cyril owned in the time before the shadows. But Maggie wasn't fooled. The curve and tapering of the tusks made their truth obvious. The shadow's limbs stretched like chewing gum as the light faded further, its steps growing more uncertain until it collapsed. The remains oozed down the side of the boulder to nestle in the womb of deeper darkness at its base. Light's children died when she did. Once, Maggie would have welcomed the night. She would have released her invisibility power and relaxed. But now she rarely let down the shield that hid her from the world.
"Girl, can you hear my stomach grumbling?"
"No, meh."
"It's like a pack of wild dogs. They want to bite your nose off."
Maggie chuckled.
"Only my nose."
"It is a Pinocchio nose."
Pauline made a quiet, disapproving sound.
"And it's become very long from your lies about hurrying with the food."
No. Pauline hadn't died. That was just another illusion Arno had inflicted on her the day he attacked her mind. Nevertheless, the guilt that lie had embedded in her chest was real. The pointed tip of it emerged near the bottom of her collarbone, something often felt but rarely seen.
"I'm doing it now, meh."
Maggie left the fence and went back to kneel among the untidy clumps of wild spinach.
"And you should have been doing it just now already."
Maggie sighed and lifted the knife she'd brought to cut the leaves.
"You must find something nice to feed those chickens, girl,"
Pauline said.
"They haven't been giving eggs."
"There's probably beetle grubs in the compost pile."
"Then you must dig them out. Some worms, too."
"There's no way I'm giving them any of my worms."
Who do you think you are talking to?
Maggie peered at Pulleng and withered in her glare. Sorry, Meh. Pulleng sucked her teeth and primly crossed her legs.
This girl.
Maggie ducked her head. Meh Pulleng hadn't been exiled. She'd chosen to follow Maggie out here, to a lonely house edged by the Seven Dams Nature Reserve and the Bloemfontein Botanical Gardens, so she wouldn't be alone. Maggie had vowed she'd show her appreciation by never speaking back to Pulleng or arguing with her or being anything less than good and dutiful, but it was difficult to maintain. Maggie gathered the greens and they left the gardens as the jackals started singing in the low hills to the northeast. She let Pulleng walk ahead of her on the narrow dirt path curving up the slope to the pale blue house that wasn't home. Pulleng had started a fire in the pit outside the back door before joining her in the garden. The flames had settled now, but the coals burned bright around the base of the cast iron pot. Maggie lifted the lid, releasing a plume of steam with a savoury scent, and threw the greens she'd gathered into the pot just as they were.
What do you think you are doing? Pulleng shouted. You must chop that first. How do you throw maroch into the stew without chopping it, Maggie?
Maggie opened her mouth to reply, but Pulleng was still ranting.
Oh, not know how to cook even this basic thing.
Pulleng glared at her, waiting for a response.
But the leaves are small, and you are hungry.
The distant thrum of an engine cut her short. Maggie stared out into the pale night. A few stars twinkled in the blackness beyond the lines of clouds crossing the sky. The one light of a sickle moon glinted vaguely on the corrugated iron rooftops of distant houses. Further off, a few tall buildings in Bloemfontein rose like blackened fangs around the faint ambient glow of light from the zoo and the nearby hotel where the other survivors lived in their solar-powered paradise. The only other light was a stark white that flickered and flashed, silhouetting pointed roofs and leafy trees in one of the suburbs that lined the far edge of the nature reserve.
That's Enzo's baki,
Pulleng said. Maggie nodded.
Hey, he must be coming to take us home.
Maggie didn't answer, didn't want to be labelled a pessimist for stating obvious truths. Instead, she squatted down to tend the fire, secure in her invisibility shield.
Eish, girl, are you seriously going to sit here and hide when Enzo's coming to take us home?
Yes, Maggie replied. Because even in her most vivid and realistic unrealities, home was lost to her forever. Engine sounds travelled far in a world where the only competition came from crickets, occasional birds, and the screams of animals falling prey to predators. The food was ready before the headlights from Enzo's bucky stopped outside the gate. Maggie sat on the back step, legs stretched out toward the fire, and delivered another spoonful of bean and wild spinach stew to her mouth. The headlights cut out, but the cab lit up when the driver's side door opened, reflecting off Enzo's glasses and revealing the pale, bearded stranger beside him. Had Enzo and the others found more survivors since they exiled her? How could they, now they didn't have an invisible girl who could safely go where she pleased? Faisal could make electricity sing and dance, and probably use his ability to power drones, too.
Maggie!
Enzo had stepped out of the car. He turned on a floodlight torch, and Maggie shielded her eyes with one arm.
Maggie!
Maybe she's out hunting.
That had to be the stranger. His voice carried an English private school accent, like that boy Lebo brought to one of Maggie's parties, or that weird girl who played drums in What's-His-Name's band. Long ago people, ghosts without relevance.
Then what do we do? Look for the girl or wait?
Another voice she didn't recognize, but this one was sharp, and his accent was Carp's. Where the hell did Enzo find these people? Surely even a Faisal-powered drone couldn't fly all the way to Cape Town.
No, she's here, Enzo sighed. She just isn't coming out. Maggie!
He raised his voice again. Please, I need to speak to you. It's important. Maggie stood and stretched. The answer was simple. Enzo didn't find these people. Her mind was playing unrealities for her again. Dread twined through her ribs, tightening her chest. She didn't want to do this, not now or ever again. Where had Pauline gone to?
I see your shadow, Maggie.
So what? She called back, already turning to go inside.
I have to speak with you, Margaret.
That was the hoity-toity dude's voice again. It was followed by the squeak of the gate opening and hurried footsteps.
All of our survival depends on it, depends on you, he continued, his voice drawing closer.
Maggie opened the door and kicked off her shoes. Any minute now. He groaned like sickness and slow death. The only thing about life that was constant and certain was her invisibility's shield's ability to render her unseen and repulse anything that tried to get close to her. The guy with the carp's accent was shouting now, his voice mingling with Enzo's into a vaguely annoying buzz. They were flies on a corpse you haven't seen yet. Where was Pauline? Maggie navigated the kitchen by familiarity, striding through the darkness to switch on the portable solar battery she used to power the lights. HCOM's load shedding had left a useful legacy of power-generating equipment in the dust and bones of middle-class houses. The LCD screen flickered on, showing it had 2 bars left.
You are too stubborn, Maggie. Go speak to Enzo.
There she was. Maggie sighed and turned on the kitchen lamp. They aren't real, meh.
Then how do I know Enzo is here?
Maggie turned to study Pauline. She posed a good question, but also she'd braided her hair flat against her scalp in the time between finishing her meal and now. Her fingers must have moved like lightning to finish the style, never mind the tiny blue flowers she'd woven into a crown over the top of her head. She was dressed to impress.
This is real, Margaret, real and urgent.
The man was leaning in the doorway, red-faced and sweating. She stepped toward him and he grimaced, his teeth showing white and sharp beneath a brown beard streaked with grey.
Rob? I'm fine,
the man replied. He scanned the room, looking through and past her, before his gaze settled near her feet.
Margaret, please let me speak to you.
Night was advancing, and she had to make a run to one of her supply caches for more sump and tins of curry. Pauline had specifically asked her to fetch those things. It would be an onerous task if she had delusions dogging her steps all night. But Pauline could see them. The things in her unrealities had a tendency to get worse the longer she ignored them. Pauline had even braided flowers into her hair to look nice. This Rob guy's sharp teeth implied he'd try to bite her.
Margaret?
Okay, speak.
Maggie lifted herself up to sit on the kitchen counter. A moment of indulgence now could prevent them chasing her later if they were false and keep Pauline happy if they were real. Pauline cleared her throat.
Your power, Maggie. You are being so rude to leave it working.
But it's keeping me safe, Maggie replied.
You are already safe. Enzo wouldn't bring people here to hurt us, and I'm here.
Maggie released her shield and looked pointedly at where Pauline stood. Pauline gave her a stiff nod of approval, and Maggie didn't voice any of the snarky comments that entered her mind.
Thank you.
The man visibly relaxed. He looked at her then, brow corrugated over wide eyes that scanned her like they didn't know where to look first. Maggie felt naked. Without her shield, all the spears of guilt and furry mold that infected her was on display, and there was nothing to keep him safe and distant. She should have put flowers in her hair too, and thorns.
My name is Rob, he said. When the change happened...
The change?
He nodded.
The moment the shadow monsters appeared and so many of us died.
He'd given it a fancy name. What a weirdo.
Just call it the apocalypse, because that's what it was.
His hands rubbed together.
Apocalypse is a word with religious connotations that don't really fit. That's not a discussion for now, however.
Rob, are you okay?
The other stranger bounded onto the back step and put a hand on Rob's shoulder. He was around her age, early 20s, with a pair of short horns growing from his forehead that curved into three symmetrical spirals. Maggie wanted to cut them off and stick them on the end of a drill so she could watch them rotating, the post-apocalyptic version of those try-not-to-be-satisfied videos she used to watch on YouTube.
I'm fine, Freddy.
Rob waved the younger guy off, his gaze never leaving her.
Can I have those horns when you're dead?
Freddy also turned to look at her then, his eyes narrowing in a calculating way. Over his shoulder, Enzo's face appeared, dripping concern in fat, pus-coloured globs. Rage flared, bright and hot in her veins. He looked different on the outside. The horrific wound he'd gotten when Arno attacked had become a web of pink scar tissue across the right side of his face. He'd lost his ear that night, and it seemed he was using a headband to hold his glasses in place. Would the glass shatter and pierce his eyes if she hit him in the face hard enough?
This is turning into a fucking party, Maggie muttered.
Too late, she realized her mistake and turned to Puleng to apologize for swearing. But Puleng had left the room. She must have realized this was bullshit. Or she'd disappeared because this was false, while Puleng remained in reality.
When the change occurred, I gained a supernatural power, just like every other survivor, Rob said. The thing I wanted most in that moment manifested in reality.
It was both freeing and frightening to be without Puleng. She missed her already, but with her absent, Maggie could say or do whatever she pleased to these freaks.
My power is clairvoyance, Rob continued.
The ability to see the future.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.